So, if anyone knows me, they'll know that I love my art. Since moving to London, I've been to so many great exhibitions and galleries. But something I hadn't considered until recently is how the video games that I played when I was younger have affected my look at art. Are video games art? I think the answer to that is yes, they certainly can be. While I would say that not all games are made primarily with an artistic intention in mind, I think it's impossible to completely separate video games from the realm of art. All games contain art to some degree, whether that's more obvious things such as box art or character design and animation, or more subtle things such as storytelling or character development and interactions, all the way down to small things such as user interface design, or the way objects interact under a game's physics engine. Some games, such as Dear Esther, go even closer towards art that they're no longer really even considered proper games. Although some people who find them boring will just call them a walking simulator. Others even include explicit references to real-life pieces of art, such as Judith beheading Holofernes by Caravaggio and The School of Athens by Raphael being used in Resident Evil games. However, in this video, I wanted to look at the relationship between art and video games both way around. That is, how the art world has influenced video games, how art is influenced by video games, and how my perception of art has been changed by the video games that I've played. So, let's get into it. Part 1. Art on video games. Some games very successfully recreate a specific architectural or graphic style. One great example is the underwater city of BioShock, which successfully recreates, adapts, and adjusts Art Deco styling from the 1920s in its architecture, typefaces, posters, and even in-game menus. Commonly used as a shorthand for luxury and exuberance, the Art Deco styling perfectly reflects the themes of overindulgence, including the misuse of Adam, a chemical substance that rewrites the user's genetic makeup, the easy availability of ammunition from vending machines, and the imperative to look beautiful, no matter the cost. Another good example of a game with a specific art style is Cuphead, drawing direct inspiration from the cartoons of the 1930s by Disney and other studios. The Walking Dead game by Telltale Games, rest in peace, features a beautifully melancholic, muted cartoon style, inspired by the graphic novel of the same name. Don't Starve uses an illustration style reminiscent of Tim Burton films. Some games feature art as a gameplay mechanic. In Amnesia: The Dark Descent, your surroundings become more distorted the more insane you become, including these portraits of Alexander that are transformed into grotesque monsters. The time-based puzzle game Braid has you collect puzzle pieces that form a piece of artwork that can be interacted with to advance. Art is also a common puzzle element in the Resident Evil game series, including pushing sculptures, combining coloured light, burning paintings, and even casting shadows from abstract wooden objects. Many games also include painting as a core mechanic. Okami is presented in a beautiful Sumie ink wash style and includes the celestial brush, which can be used to paint and interact with the environment. Other games, such as Portal 2 and Splatoon, also use paint, although I'm aware this is getting a bit abstract and maybe it's just called making a mess. Art can also feature more generally in video games. For example, the halls of Hogwarts in the various Harry Potter games are filled with portraits taking inspiration from classic art, as well as stone reliefs, statues, and suits of armor throughout. The Crash Bandicoot games contain adaptations of ancient stone structures and totem poles in jungle levels and ice levels, and the stone walls of the pyramids in Crash Bandicoot 3 Warped contain fun images of the characters in an ancient Egyptian style. And of course, we have painting in The Sims. It's clear then that art, in its many forms, has an obvious influence, whether direct or otherwise, on video games. But what about the other way around? Part 2. Video games on art. Examples of video games directly influencing art and art culture are far less common, as video games only really started existing in the early 1970s, with Pong releasing in 1972. The time period since the first games came out is obviously far shorter compared to the existence of art as a whole, where the earliest painting is thought to be over 40,000 years old. In fact, the earliest evidence of artistic activity occurring at all is over 500,000 years ago by way of geometric incisions on a shell by archaic humans known as Homo erectus. Board games, on the other hand, have existed since around 3500 BC, and their existence in art is almost as old. where we have examples of board games being played in ancient Egypt, medieval Europe, and Edo period Japan. Video games have had far less time to assimilate into the world of art, although there are some great examples of video games in art. Gran Turismo, a fantastic oil painting by Megan J. Davies, features two teenage brothers engrossed in the PlayStation racing game in their grandmother's house in Enfield, North London, while she watches on from the corner of the sofa. Lemmings, from the game of the same name, are immortalised in bronze by Alison Conway and Powderhall Bronze near their birthplace in Dundee, due to their creation by DMA Design in 1991. There are also artworks that, while not depicting specific games, allude to video game worlds. For example, Julian Opie has created many works where bold colours and clean edges mirror the simple polygons used in early video games. His works, Imagine You Were Driving and Imagine You Were Walking, directly put the viewer in first person in these surreal but simple worlds, being reminiscent of early games such as Super Mario Kart and Doom due to the distinctive 3D perspective used and barren environment. I also like to imagine this piece, Cars, is actually from Frogger's perspective as he's trying to cross the busy road. Keith Haring's work in the 1980s is very bold and often also extremely colourful, and although I couldn't find any pieces that directly reference video games, it's not hard to imagine that he was influenced in some way by the ever-evolving video game industry. The 1980s saw the continued success of arcade companies like Atari and Namco, the video game crash of 1983, thanks a lot E.T., and the rejuvenation of the industry with the NES in 1985. Keith Haring himself was sceptical of and ambivalent towards the apparent rise of modern technology, evident in some of his work. Televisions and computers were often used as shorthand for mass media and technology, where it was commonly shown in a negative light. For example, in an untitled piece from 1983, a monstrous and gluttonous caterpillar is given a computer for a head, suggesting the endless consumption of modern media. One of the earliest pieces I found that somewhat resembles video gaming is an oil painting called The Entertainment Machine by Peter Phillips in 1961, a full decade before the video game industry really kicked off. Phillips would often create paintings based off game boards as a compositional device, where this piece uses a similar approach but in a more abstract way, combining board game ideas with machine parts, piano keys, targets, and a distorted face. The overall image is future thinking and a mood board for what entertainment is and could be. While video games themselves are becoming more and more recognized as an art form, they are generally kept separate from more traditional forms of art, like paintings and sculpture. However, there have been moments in recent years where they've been given a spotlight in the art world. The Smithsonian American Art Museum held an exhibition called The Art of Video Games in 2012, exploring 40 years of video games as an art form, focusing on games that have strong visual design and exhibit new technology. The Museum of Modern Art has 23 games in its permanent collection to showcase games with interesting design, with a lean towards early arcade and 8-bit games. The Victoria and Albert Museum recently hosted Video Games Design, Play, Disrupt, exploring the design and surrounding culture of video games, which I actually went to, as well as going behind the scenes with concept art. The exhibition also presented commentary from industry members, looking at topics such as a lack of gender diversity, the impact of violence and guns, and games as a platform for social and political issues. Although games don't hold the same prestige as other forms of art, I think it's important that they're at least starting to be recognised for their artistic merits. So why aren't they viewed to the same standard? There's a few obvious reasons. Games are often seen by the general public as a teenage boy kind of hobby, and also physically installing game exhibits in spaces such as museums and galleries can be time-consuming and impractical. Games are also unique in that each person receives a slightly different experience, unlike, for example, paintings, which generally retain a fixed form. Another interesting point that I came across is that nostalgia is generally looked upon unfavorably in the art world, as it is an easy method of evoking an emotional response from the viewer, and doesn't necessarily let the piece of art speak for itself. Including video game references in art would almost certainly lead to a nostalgic response from the viewer. However, I don't personally feel that a nostalgic feeling is necessarily bad, and in fact, looking at some pieces of art remind me of video games, without them ever even containing any references to games at all, having been painted before video games existed as a medium. So, that leads us to part 3, art that reminds me of video games. Did I make this section just to talk about art that I like? Yes, obviously. However, I do think it's worth looking at art to see how principles such as colour palette, contrast, and texture translate into video games. For example, the dark gruesomeness of Saturn Devouring His Son by Goya parallels well with the grisly gore of early Resident Evil games, with the gloomy corridors and bright red splashes of blood as zombies devour your flesh. One of my favourite pieces of art, The Ambassadors by Holbein the Younger, gives me strong fond memories of Harry Potter and the Chamber of Secrets game. Partly due to the hundreds of paintings found on the walls of Hogwarts, I'm also reminded of the Chamber of Secrets due to the warm colours used in the piece, similar to the rich woods, colourful rugs, and blazing fires used throughout the game. This painting also has numerous secrets, including the stretched skull, the crucifix in the corner, and hidden meanings behind some of the objects, such as this broken string. This is paralleled by the seemingly endless hidden rooms and secrets found throughout the game. Another one of my favourite games, Spyro 2 Gateway to Glimmer, or Ripto's Rage in America, has a level called Sunny Beach, which has a strong blue and yellow colour scheme. This level is extremely nostalgic for me due to its inclusion in a demo for the game, and so it has stuck with me forever. When I went to see the Keith Haring exhibition at the Tate Liverpool, I also looked around the normal collection, and my eye was immediately caught by the painting The Beached Margin by Edward Wadsworth. The pale blues and creams and interesting sea-themed objects took me straight back to Sunny Beach. Looking around the Tate Britain in London, I also fell in love with a few other paintings that also remind me of this level, such as Scylla by Aethel Colquhoun, and another piece by Edward Wadsworth, Bronze Ballet. Half-Life 2 has also been a very important game to me. When I first played it, I had no idea what it was, only having played it as it came with part of the orange box with Portal. But man, that game blew me away. I think the dystopian themes have also stuck with me, and the painting Three Studies of Figures at the Base of a Crucifixion by Francis Bacon really reminds me of some themes from the game. Besides the obvious orange colour, there's also parallels between the alien forms of the Furies in the painting and the various Combine war machines. Having been completed in the final months of the Second World War, the painting for some reflected the horror of the Holocaust and the increasing fear of nuclear weapons. Events echoed in Half-Life 2 with the domination of the human race on Earth, suppressed sexual reproduction, and removal of freedoms. I think this is a great example of how both video games and art are platforms for storytelling and emotion.
Welcome. Welcome to City 17. You have chosen or been chosen to relocate.
So, art in video games. Two things that hold distinctive positions in the realm of art, but things that are inseparable, both in the mind and in reality in some cases. If you like this video, please give it a like, and if you want to see what I do in the future, please subscribe. And as always, thanks for watching. You